afternoon, South Africa. Welcome to Afternoon Express. It's so good to be back. I haven't seen you guys in a long, long, long time. I've really missed you. This is actually my first show of the year, of 2019.
Welcome back, buddy. I missed you from the depths of my soul, my older sister, my mentor, my everything.
I missed you too. I missed you all. Now, I heard it was glitz and glam for you this past weekend. Now, this past Saturday, mm-hmm. Cape Town sparkled with celebrities, fashion, and champagne at the 157th running of the Sun Met. Racegoers interpreted the 2019 theme of precious metals with hues of bronze, gold, and silver in high-end fashion pieces.
I mean, I'm definitely still in Met mode, rocking my afro.
I
had an absolute blast at the Met, seeing everyone on the red carpet, and just the experience of being at the races, unmatched, I tell you.
Absolutely. Now, today on the show, we have a special performance from the award-winning music trio, Beatenberg. We chat about their new album, 12 Views of Beatenberg. We also chat to Andrew Clark and Christopher Davids, who run youth entrepreneur seminars to assist young entrepreneurs with their business ventures.
Ah, such an incredible topic. It's important, being a Monday.
Yeah.
So important. Heading into the week, having full knowledge of everything we need to equip us to be successful in life. Plus, we chat to Felicity Guest, who is the founder and co-director of Child Maintenance in South Africa. And we also meet Ronelle Steenekamp, who is the founder of Solo Single Moms Empowerment, a platform that offers mental, emotional, professional support to single mothers. Remember to hit us up on social media and let us know, how do you deal with failure? Tweet us at Afternoon Chat using the hashtag Afternoon Express or comment on our Facebook page.
Absolutely. With the release of their debut album in 2014, Beatenberg introduced a unique sound that took over the pop genre, exploring Kwaito, house, and Bakanga. They have broken radio chart records and won numerous awards as a result, including a sweep of SAMA Awards. They're back this year with the brand new album, 12 Views of Beatenberg, and we get to hear it live in the loft later on.
Waiting forever, waiting together. My head's in the way, my head's in the way, my head's in the way of my heart. Head's in the way, my head's in the way, my head's in the way of my heart. Chelsea Blakemore. I don't wanna play this game. Chelsea Blakemore. I don't wanna call you.
Please welcome onto the loft, Beatenberg. Welcome back. Lovely to have you back with us.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
What immediately strikes me about you is you have a very different real life appearance and your image to your on stage. Would you say
this
that?
Is part of the on stage.
Is it?
As well.
Is this part of the on stage?
Yeah, this is not real life yet.
Well, I just saw in the music, I guess that's
right.
The music video.
Yeah, that was
you
a particular.
You just look proper Capetonian, I guess.
What, now or in the
yeah,
video?
Yeah, right now.
Oh, okay. Okay. Well, that's cool.
I'm
okay.
Feeling it. I'm here for it.
Yeah.
I'm here for it.
Yeah. Yeah.
So your first album did extraordinarily well. Mm. Did you expect that?
Basically, no.
I don't think you could expect something like that. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, we hoped it would do well, but we had no idea.
Yeah, and I'm sure it was a whirlwind, but what are some of the challenges that came with it happening so quickly and so furiously?
I was still working, for example. Like, I was in an office, and then I'd be catching emails.
What were you doing?
I was a web developer, building websites and stuff. And then I'd be getting emails like, yo, your song just hit number one on like a certain radio station. I'd be like, oh wait, I gotta finish this thing I'm doing. And then talk the next 8 hours of work, and then every day, you know what I mean? It was just getting out of control. Mm. It was crazy.
Yeah? And any other challenges you experienced? Just the fame? What did the fame feel like?
That was intense. I mean, it's still like a learning.
Keeping in touch with like what really
matters.
Means to you. That's I guess the challenge.
Yeah.
Just making sure that you're doing it for the, not necessarily for the same reason you started, but for a reason that is still true to you, and not just because you're doing it.
Yeah.
I think we've been like finding our way with that.
And how do you find the balance between making sure that you're not just releasing albums for the sake of having to release another album, but that you feel like it's time and that you're ready, but also pushing yourself at the same time?
I think we always want to release albums for the sake of just music. Like, I guess it took us a long time to do this last one, but It's not because we don't want to release a lot of albums, I guess. I don't know.
I think this, I think I'm not really it's taken the spirit of time because we were dealing with kind of the success of the last album and processing what that meant to us and what is important to us. And you know, that's musically, personally, everything, you know.
Yeah.
So I think it's been sort of a period of figuring a lot of things out.
Yeah. So your new offering is called 12 Views of Beatenberg. There's an interesting story behind it. It's very philosophical. Tell me about it.
Maybe. I guess, I don't know if it's, it's hard to explain these things. I guess it's just that there were, ironically, there are more than 12 songs on it. The initial idea was that there'd be 12 songs. I thought it'd be kind of funny in the end that there were more songs than the views, because, you know, the 12 views corresponded to the songs. I'm not very good at talking about what it means.
Well, there's
the whole mountain. There's the whole Table Mountain.
There's a mountain.
Mount Beatenberg.
Yeah, I mean, Berg obviously means
But there's
mountain.
Also this angle, which I explained to a friend the other day, which is that there's a play on words, which is that there are our views, but there are also views of us. It's like perspectives on the band.
That's one
but
of the
it's
things.
Also these are our perspectives, if you know what I mean.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like how we get to express something and also be read as certain types of people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which is nice. It's kind of subtle.
It is. Yeah. What can we expect from this album?
I think a lot of new sounds. I think it's not necessarily what everyone's going to be expecting, but I think if you give it the time and the energy and the... I think you already enjoy it.
Jeez, guys. Yeah. I can't stop
we're
you
like
from
in
talking.
A quiet
I can't stop you from talking today. And any exciting collaborations that you hooked up with?
Well, you know, Matt wrote a song with Trezor, Aphrodite. Mm,
that's the only one on the album.
Yeah.
But it's a cool one.
Incredible song.
Such really a great song.
Yeah, I think you guys do have a knack for choosing the right kind of collaborations.
Yeah,
thank
that's
you.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Really important.
You guys are going to perform She's Not Like That shortly. What's it about?
You're going to make me not talk again. I don't really know.
I know,
I was thinking about that just now. I was trying to think about what it's about when I was looking out the window. Now. I don't know, really. I don't know. I'll have to think about that.
Okay. Well, I'm glad you're going to sing it to us, at least.
Yeah, yeah.
It's so great to have you back in the loft, and we look forward to your performance.
Yeah. Cool. Thanks very much.
Cool.
Zero Monday Blues in the loft today with Beatenberg in the building. Okay, I think I need to get over my fan moment. And whilst I do that, after the break, we'll be spreading a little Krush goodness with radio personality Dineo Ranaka at Thembalihle Primary School. Plus, we chat to Andrew Clark and Christopher Davis, who is running an entrepreneur seminars that assists young entrepreneurs with their business ventures. You definitely don't want to miss that.
Clover Krush, 100% pure fruit juice packed with vitamins and no added sugar. Krush, your daily dose of goodness. Now also available in Long Life.
Made with love by Clover.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express. It is indeed such a pleasure to be back with you. Much like relationship goals, we all have property goals and dreams of owning that house on the beach or that penthouse overlooking the city. Now, private property is encouraging you to share your property dreams and stand a chance to win 10,000 Rand. To enter, visit privateproperty.co.za and search for your dream home. Then use the social media icons to share it to your Twitter or Facebook. And don't forget to tag @PropertySA with #PropertyDreams. It's that simple. So go ahead, share, and you could win 10,000 Rand with Private Property. T's and C's can be found on privateproperty.co.za.
Clover Krush, 100% pure fruit juice packed with vitamins and no added sugar. Krush, your daily dose of goodness. Now also available in Long Life.
With love by Clover.
Now, children represent the future, and if we can add a little goodness to their lives, it has the power to transform for a better society. Now, goodness has been at the core of everything that Clover Krush stands for, above and beyond its great tasting juice. Now, the return of the Krush Goodness campaign is showing that spreading goodness every day has the power to change the world for the better. Now, to help them do this, they invited one of South Africa's most loved personalities, Dineo Ranaka, to be a part of the Krush Goodness crew and to help them distribute Smart Step school shoes to deserving learners in Thembalihle Primary School.
Here at Thembalihle Primary is where businesswoman, radio and TV presenter Dineo Ranaka swapped out her heels for an entire school's worth of new Smart Step school shoes with the Clover #CrushGoodness campaign.
I know what it's like to not have. I know what it's like to be a child who has parents that are going through financial lows. I've seen it myself with my parents. And also, I've grown to be a very grateful adult, and I'm very much aware of the terrible financial situation in many South African households. So partnering with a brand like Clover Krush to actually help out and release the stress, relieve parents of stress and children of stress, and restore dignity by a simple gesture. Having something new gives you that feeling of newness. It gives you that feeling of worthiness. It gives you that feeling of yes. So we want to give these kids that feeling of feeling brand spanking new.
Well, when the learners saw Dineo Ranaka, entering their class, you know, they only saw her on TV. So for them seeing her here, right here, so they were really, really, really excited and happy when they received each new box of shoe. I saw them screaming, literally see tears coming out from their faces because of joy that they have and because of the new pair of shoes that they've just received from Clover Krush.
The reason why we wanted to bring back again this year bigger is because we understand the importance of education, and that at the beginning of the day, it's very important that the kids get the pair of school shoes. Kids go to school every year, so it was very important for us to come in again and do the Krush Goodness campaign.
I'm excited because I got brand new school shoes from Clover Krush. I like about my shoes because they are strong and last me even a year.
My shoes were broken and now I have new school shoes. Now I am happy because I have new school shoes.
I will say thank you to Clover to give me shoes and juice to drink and shoes to go to school.
I love my school shoes because they are so nice, they are shiny, and they come from far.
It's absolutely incredible to witness how rapidly a little dose of goodness can spread. Remembering to do good and to share the goodness, it really is contagious. Like fast, proper fast.
They weren't done yet. Next, Dineo and Krush shared the goodness with Orlando Children's Home and their director, Miriam Mazibuko.
Every morning, I say, God, help me to touch the lives of the little ones so that they can be positive about life, they can grow up positively, and they can be better adults of tomorrow. Thank you for joining me in touching the lives positively of these little ones that we are taking care of.
I always think, what if my kids had less? What if my kids didn't have the opportunities that they have. It's a reality for many children. And for me, it's also a very big important thing as a parent to teach my children, be grateful for what you have, and with what you have, share with those that don't have as much as you have.
Oh, wow, I love that insert. It's so heartwarming. It's also said that the first 3 years of a new business are the most crucial, and after numerous failures and successes in business, Andrew Clark and Christopher Davids were inspired to create seminars that assist young entrepreneurs with their business ventures. Their seminars help their entrepreneurs get back on their feet after setbacks. Today, they are sharing something important, business hacks for aspiring entrepreneurs. Welcome to The Loft, Andrew, Christopher. Lovely to have you with us.
Thank you. Awesome. Thanks a lot.
So reading just your bio and everything you've been through, it sounds like you were quite inspired by failure, that moment after failure, and how you then pick yourself up and climb that mountain again.
Absolutely, because it's a very lonely place to be. If you've been retrenched, if you lose your business, your family throws you out, your friends don't like you anymore, you don't get child support, you're alone, you're single, there's nobody. They love you when you're rich, everybody's around you, but when you fall, there's nobody.
Wow.
And we have to find a way to help people when they're in that dark place.
Yeah.
And there is, you know, there's so much that we can do.
Absolutely.
The behavior profiler, for instance, what we do is we first look at your behavior and why do you do what you do? What is your reaction to things? So the whole seminar, the whole day, gets you to understand why you do what you do.
So let me understand, the behavior profiler is the name of your program, and when people want to come to attend your seminars, they have to fill out this questionnaire that then reveals to them their behavior traits and how they react to things.
Correct.
Do you find people are very honest when answering?
The thing is, it's a self-reflecting tool, so you can change your behavior. You know, your beliefs forms your behavior and then your habits. So if you can change your beliefs, which is impregnated into you because of the culture scape we live in, the things that we are forced to believe is the right thing, taught by our friends, our family, our schools, our society, and before we know it, we're living something that's not us.
Wow.
And that's why I believe the South African youth actually have more opportunity than international youth, because education hasn't drummed their own personalities out of them.
Yeah.
We have a creative youth. So if we could just get youth to understand that the world's their oyster, where are the days where we had hope in this country? Where are the days we had faith when we believed in this country? Everybody runs around negative now.
Yeah.
It's time for us to go back to our roots and the faith that we have for this country. Remember those last 3 seconds before that ball went over the goalpost in the World Cup?
Yeah.
Where's that?
Yeah.
Where's that?
Yeah.
We have it. All we have to do is open our eyes and start looking at the people that need us.
And tap into that.
100%.
Christopher, you're one such youth who benefited from one of the seminars.
Yeah.
And you went on to start your own community development projects. Please take us through it.
Yeah, basically I saw an opportunity. He opened my eyes in a massive way. Now our community needs something like this because there's so many people falling into poverty, drug abuse and gangsterism in our own community ourselves. So I want to set the chains, and he has helped me find connect with entrepreneurs and connect with people that actually need the chains.
Yeah.
So he's helped me in that aspect where I can actually use what I learned from him and be the mentor where it's needed.
Absolutely, yeah.
So
if you could give us just like in point form, what are the essential tools that you think young entrepreneurs need to have that thick skin and that ability to, that tenacity?
You know what? Together we are stronger. We need to form a tribe. We need to form a place where when you're down and out and your dreams are there, where you can go to, where you can share. You and I have social capital. If I have an issue, I have a friend that's a lawyer. If I need a loan, I can call up a friend. If I need something, I've got somewhere to go. But a young entrepreneur that's in a township that has to fight for food to feed his family and his mother, where does he go when he fails? So my dream is, and I sort of like impregnated Christopher with this idea, is for us to form a tribe where we can get together, where if you need something, you've got someone to talk to, because there's nowhere to go. If you and I need inspiration, we walk into a bookstore, and we buy a self-help book.
Yeah.
If you need to go to a seminar, you pay 6,000-7,000 rand and you listen to somebody speaking and making you jump up and down and you walk out there all pumped up. Where does somebody go that hasn't got data?
Yeah, and that's what you're offering.
This is where we're going. We want to go around this country. We want to take corporate social investment and invest that money properly. and get to young children and get them onto places. We've got a whole concept where you'll be able to download data within around a certain areas, so people can go in there, download the data, go back home, watch it, inspire themselves, yeah. and grow. The law of growth is one of the most important things that we have forgotten. You can't go from 1 to 25. You have to go to 2,
yeah,
to 3,
three
to 4. And the only way we can do that is by taking their hands and helping them.
Wow, it sounds like such an incredible project. And thank you so much for the work that you're doing.
Thanks for the opportunity. Yeah.
Whilst those powerful words sink in, I want all of us to head over to social media and tweet us. Let us know, how do you deal with failure? Tweet us at Afternoon Chat using the hashtag Afternoon Express or comment on our Facebook page. Now we chat to the founder and the co-director of Child Maintenance Difficulties, Felicity Guest, after the break. Express
yourself. Clover Krush, 100%. Pure fruit juice packed with vitamins and no added sugar. Krush, your daily dose of goodness. Now also available in Long Life.
With love by Clover.
Lovely to have you back with us on Afternoon Express. Now, a report from the South African Institute of Race Relations revealed that only 33% of children live with both parents. For those in single-parent homes, 39% live with their mother, while only 4% live with their father. Founder of Child Maintenance Difficulties, Felicity Guest, started a group in order to empower single mothers by offering advice to those experiencing difficulties in obtaining child maintenance, as well as advice on how single parents can co-parent effectively. Felicity, welcome to The Loft. Lovely to have you with us.
Thank you for having me.
I love how the name of your organization just cuts straight to the chase, Child Maintenance Difficulties in South Africa. And most people, when you talk about child maintenance, the first word that comes to mind is difficulty.
Yes.
Why do we find ourselves there? And your decision to start this organization was actually sparked by a personal experience.
Yes, it was very much so. My own journey has been a very troublesome one, which started with a fraudulent divorce. And in the divorce, he said he had no children. So I was unable to claim maintenance. I then had to apply to have that set aside and then institute divorce proceedings. So it took a number of years from the time I got separated. So I was already experiencing the abusive side of it. And then when my divorce went through, I thought, well, at least now I'm going to get relief from the courts. Yay, I have a maintenance agreement in place. Yeah. And that was quite a rude awakening for me, because when I went to the courts and I tried to enforce a court order, it was the most frustrating, emotionally debilitating process ever, because it was postponements, it's sitting on court benches all day and dealing with staff that you're just another number, not respecting the absolute impact that it had on me personally. So one day, coming back from another very disappointing day in court, I just burst into tears. In fact, I'd done a bit of a sit-in at Newspaper House out of my sheer frustration.
Yeah.
And then I went home and I just like was besides myself. And I said, what are other women doing?
This How are they tough. Coping with this?
Yeah. I've had resources. What are other women doing who don't have the resources that I have? And I got into my computer and I said, Facebook, that's surely I can connect with people. And it was, what am I going to call it? Call it what it is.
What it is.
Child maintenance difficulties in South Africa.
Wow.
And that was 4 years ago, and it's grown very organically since then. It was slow in the beginning, but obviously with more awareness created, that we are pretty close to 50,000 members now, which is, how popular we are. It is just what a huge pandemic
what
this really is.
What a huge need there is,
absolutely.
Right? I mean, we could speak forever about just the emotional drainage that that whole process is for single mothers and divorced mothers and all that. But just legally, what are the requirements for child maintenance? On what grounds can a mother or father claim child maintenance?
So in the Children's Act, it is very clear that the child has rights. The child has a right to be financially supported by both parents, and it also has a right to have a relationship with both parents.
Mm.
And that is enshrined in our Bill of Rights and in our Constitution, which is the best interest of the child, which is paramount. So that should supersede every other little objection that comes up along the way. So normally, one parent post-relationship, whether that's marriage or just cohabiting, is awarded primary care.
Right.
And the person that has primary care obviously needs financial assistance.
Yes.
But it's not the mother's right to financial support, it's the child's right to financial support.
Mm.
And we need to start seeing it in that way as a society, because it takes the person who's just representing the child in court out of the equation and focuses it back onto the child's needs.
Yes.
And there's it ends up being very problematic, because invariably there's unresolved conflict
between the two parents. Yeah, yeah.
So often it becomes a grudge payment.
Yeah.
So hopefully with the awareness and education that we are doing, and shows like this certainly help, is that it impacts terribly on the child. And while money is incredibly important, the child actually just wants love.
Yeah.
And the love and a relationship with both parents. So the parents, I often say, you know, adults need to adult. And adulting means growing up, becoming emotionally mature, and
just getting on with
and
it
admitting
and
if you're having if there's conflict, go and resolve the conflict.
Yeah.
That's step number one. Go the alternative dispute resolution route of mediation.
Which you advocate more for. You advocate more for mediation.
Absolutely.
Rather than going to court immediately.
Yes, because it allows the two parties to come to a mutual agreement, instead of it being adversarial and forced onto you by the court.
And a financial drain.
Correct. And you can also reach those agreements a lot quicker through mediation. And then it also, the children see that the parents are actually communicating. So if you go that route, then there's much quicker results and more benefit for the children. Going to the courts is a frustrating process. And because there's problems in all of our government departments, and the judiciary is just another one of those. With the staff, with the resources constraints, that they've reduced their staff complement. So that obviously impacts with the amount of people that they see going through the courts. The problem with that is the longer it takes to resolve a case is the longer that the child's constitutional rights are being denied.
Wow.
And that's the big problem around. And that's why it's so critical. It's forcing women further into poverty. And the majority of people who live on the poverty line are women, because there's still huge disparities
Absolutely.
In earnings.
Yeah. And you know what I love about your organisation is that you have a support group.
Yes.
So you can be found on Facebook, and it's called the CDMSA.
CMDSA.
CMDSA.
Child maintenance. Yeah.
And all the information will be on our website.
It's so important that we always put the kids first. We always want our children to have the best of the best in life. So let's put away our problems and put the children first. Thank you so much, Felicity, for all the work that you do. Let us know on social media, how have you overcome some child maintenance difficulties in your family? Who knows? Let's help each other out. Now, after the break, check out what went down at the glitzy SunMet this past Saturday. Plus, we chat to Ronelle Steenekamp, who is the founder of Solo Moms Empowerment. Happy Monday. Welcome back to Afternoon Express. Now, the Afternoon Express team had the pleasure of attending Africa's richest race day this past Saturday. As expected, our favorite celebrities came dressed to the nines, and we were there to capture it all on camera. Let's have a look at our favorite moments, from the red carpet to the horses.
Thank goodness January is ending on such a high note. All bets are set for the 2019 The SunMet, Africa's biggest and richest race day. And you know, Afternoon Express had to get in on the action. What gives the horse races such powerful staying power?
It's that tradition, and people love being part of tradition, so that's one big thing. But horse racing and fashion are synonymous. People want to come out and be seen, and that's absolutely what today is all about. So that's why Sun International, we really wanted to be part of this. It's in our DNA that we entertain people, and the SunMet was just a perfect fit.
What are you most looking forward to?
I heard there's a horse race, so I'm not sure about that, but no, man, we're just here to have a good time, you know? We're not here for a long time, we're here for a short time, but we're gonna make sure it's a good time.
Yeah, to look amazing, be around amazing people, be around new people. So yeah, just to come socialize and have a beautiful day. I mean, it's a beautiful Saturday, the sun's out, and yeah. looking like a mustard bottle here on this red carpet.
Thank you. Absolutely dapper.
Thank you. You know, listen, I feel like we both went with the same theme, precious metal, gold, out here doing our presenter search thing. It's looking good. But you look amazing.
Thank you so much. I mean, how has the journey been for you so far?
I think it's been crazy. You know, kind of everything's changed very rapidly, but I'm still kind of practicing. I'm still going out, still seeing patients, but there's like this other life where I get to come to the Sun Met and I'm on the red carpet.
What are you most looking forward to?
Honestly speaking, I got very lucky on the last time at the Queen's Plate. We're back to it again, so hopefully you can do it again for us and give us the win again. Green and gold, as you can see, we color-coded South African colors, Springbok.
I want to find out from you your execution of African luxury precious metals.
So I love gold, and when you think precious metal, the first thing that pops into your mind is gold. So I decided that I wanted to do sort of a liquid gold feel. So that's what this dress is. It's inspired by liquid gold. I wanted to look like I was dipped into a melting pot of gold, and I love it. It's effortless, it's chic, it's gaat your hand katsia, and I love it.
Gold and diamonds is just the perfect place to be. So that is what we went through, and I'm wearing a Lucy Egini, and yes, styled by Van der Vessel, so I'm excited. And the first time I'm wearing my hair curly on a red carpet, so excited.
Tamron, how is it feeling to be here today? Finally, you got your outfit together. Yeah. Who are you wearing?
So I'm wearing Cape Town dress hire. We actually just sourced the dress, and then we decided let's style it. And what we wanted to focus on was just the hair and the makeup. Try to get those medals in the hair as we did. And yeah, we're going for sleek but beautiful.
And doesn't she low-key look like she could be part of Wakanda?
Channeling it. I'm channeling the Wakanda.
What was the inspiration behind today, being the fashion man himself? We want to find out your tips and tricks for today.
Well, today was just about standing out to start off with and looking different. So C-Squared is doing that right now. You know, they're making beautiful power suits, fashionable, casual and formal. So I decided why not, you know?
Foiti, lovely having you. Looking gorgeous as always. Doesn't she look a little bit like an Oscar statue?
We're channeling what we want in the future.
Exactly. We're bringing it closer to ourselves. You are certainly a fashion man, being dubbed as one of the country's most stylish gentlemen last year. Are you going to give other kids a chance this year, please?
I can't really agree to that because I'm just doing myself, but I just believe staying true to yourself and just doing you. And for me, the stage is yours. Come and just live your dream and be the best person and just do you and be amazingly fashionable.
So Harmony claims to know a lot about fashion, and I think that it has a lot to do with his amazing mother, who is a seamstress, and I believe she put together this gorgeous look. Yo, thank you so much, Ma. Say thank you to Mom.
No, definitely thank you, Ma. This outfit is incredible, but I think the concept and the ideas, I kind of got inspiration from something that I saw, and then we adapted it, and Mom came through with the looks. I mean, I don't claim to know about fashion. Girl, look, I am fashion girl, amongst many other things.
Reached the end of the Sun Met 2019, and what an incredible day it was. Congratulations to all the winners, and until next year, see you back in the loft.
Time was had by all. Now, being a single parent is one of the most difficult tasks in the world. Now, after becoming a single mother, Ronelle Steenekamp was inspired to start a support group on social media that offers emotional and mental support to other single mothers. Welcome to the loft.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Now, I was raised by a single mother, and everybody knows the pressure that single mothers go through, the isolation, the constant pressure to show up and to overcompensate even for issues that are happening in the home. Absolutely. And it's so amazing to know that there are such things like a support group for single mothers.
Absolutely.
But what prompted you to begin this support group?
So when I first became a single mom at the age of 26, about 11 and odd years ago, I was looking for the support. So I come from a family who there's I mean, there isn't divorce, isn't the in thing, of course. Yeah. So strong marriages. And I was just looking for that support. Where do I turn to? So I went through that isolation. I didn't really have the skills to actually deal with it. And then I thought to myself, okay, so if you can't find one, why not start one? Yeah. And that's how it started. And ultimately, it didn't start through, you know, putting a brand to it. It really just started with, if I know you're a single mom, I'm there for you. Here's my number, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah. So 11 years gone by, and now, you know, supporting other single moms in small ways.
One of the most disheartening issues is the stigma that society attaches to single mothers. What are some of the ways that society views single mothers?
Yeah, look, from a, I think from a religious point of view, you know, you need to forgive. From a community point of view, you need to get married. So the single mom always feels like there's something missing. And
they
she's
did something
than.
Wrong to and end up as a single mother.
Absolutely. Yeah. So we don't like to play the blame game. So what I personally stand for, it's no one's fault. The situation is here, and let's grow healthy families. And what I advocate for is that a single parent family is still a family.
Absolutely.
And so there doesn't, you know, the narratives, there's fights and, you know, the partners hate each other. It should not be like that.
Yeah.
So I love to journey with younger single moms to get them to a point of saying, okay, we're adults now, and let's raise healthy families.
Absolutely.
Even though it's not in a marriage package.
Nucleus, yeah. Now, I'm not of the belief that children who come from single-parent homes are a write-off, or that they're less advantaged. Yeah. I mean...
Absolutely. Mama, you made it.
Exactly. But how can single mothers better support their children? Mm.
I think it's very important to deal with yourself first. And so many people ask me, so is it empowerment or is it empowerment? So no, it's empowerment. We can make up our own words, right? So empowerment really says you need to heal yourself before you can empower your kids, empower your family, community, etc. So the one of the things that we stand for is get healing. Go through the mess, go through the pain, go
Absolutely.
Through the ugliness, but get healing. And I think when you get that healing, healed people heal people.
Wow.
As much as hurt people also hurt people.
Yeah.
So that's the first step.
Yeah.
Get healing.
Wow. That is such a powerful message. It's such a powerful message. So when the mothers come to your support group, what are some of the processes you take them through?
Look, it's very simple. So at our launch event, we had fantastic speakers, various speakers touching on child maintenance, touching on career as a single mother, money, etc. But ultimately, I... really, when I founded this, I was looking at, okay, so what did I miss? Number one, I missed the empowerment thing, so the healing part. Number two is to interact with other single moms. So whenever you go to an event, you always pitch alone. Whenever you are invited to someone, you're not bringing someone with you. So that's, there's this constant isolation. Even in the business world, you're invited to events, everyone has their partner on the side or et cetera, and you alone. But it's empowerment that's gonna get you to a place to be okay alone.
Yeah.
Until you're ready.
Yeah.
What
message do you have for any single mother who's out there and find themselves parenting alone and they never expected it, it just hit them upside the head and they are feeling so stressed and isolated right now?
The first thing is, I don't think we'd have to go on the narrative of what past single mothers went through.
Yeah.
So if past single mothers' narrative is that there's problems with the dad, he doesn't do this, he doesn't do that, start with you and try to change that narrative for your family.
Wow.
That's one thing. And number two is that being a single mother is not a trap. It's not a career, you know, failure.
It's not an endless pit.
It's not an endless pit.
Yeah.
So don't allow the label of single motherhood to limit you. So if you have to take off that label, take it off and just say, okay, I don't know, I'm fantastic, and I'm going to go for whatever I need to go for. And then the third thing is that get into a circle of other single mothers. Hear their stories. More importantly, when you share your story, share the mistakes. And that's what we do at our one-on-one interactive sessions. Just to hear other people's stories, it's already such a big learning point.
Yeah, that's really important.
Yeah.
And also, as you said that, I realized that as much that as that is empowering and empowering, it also forces you to be vulnerable.
Oh, absolutely.
Right? And you need to open up to those mothers that
you then
meet. Absolutely.
And that's why you need to go through the healing yourself as well. Yeah.
Ronelle,
you can build
strong
families.
You're doing such great work.
Thank you, Bonnie. Thank you so much.
Great work indeed. And my favorite part is the empowerment. I think they need to add that to the dictionary. Now, Beatenberg gives us a much needed boost after the break as they perform their latest music live in the loft.
Cool, yeah, that's fine. I'm just a tiny bit low. I'm just going to... I know it's cheating. Yeah, one. Cool, yeah, that's good. Yeah, that's good, that's good, that's good. Shot, thank you. Oh, no, now it's too high. Just a tiny... Yeah, I think that'll be more precise. Yeah, that's good, thanks. It's too high now. It's too high and it's coming too much. Okay, there, that's fine. Yeah, that's good, that's better. Yeah, that's fine, thanks. Okay, enjoy.
Welcome back to Afternoon Express. And you know what we say here on SABC3, the stage is yours. And we're about to hand over the stage to Beatenberg. Now, Beatenberg's latest album titled 12 Views of Beatenberg was loosely inspired by Table Mountain, which brings a stifling awareness to one's place in the world and history. Performing their brand new song, She's Not Like That. Welcome, Beatenberg, ladies and gentlemen.
Holds you in her arms the whole night long. Does she love you when you're weak and when you're strong? When you argue, does she like to prove you wrong? Did she ever ask you to put her in a song? She's not like that. She's not like that. Thank you. poplar leaf. When you hold her, is it always with
Beatenberg. We're back on the couch with our fabulous ladies. You're getting so much love on social media. I think it's just because this is a conversation a lot of women are consistently having, and it's good to know that the awareness around the support that is needed is really is rising. Yeah. So what are some, I wanted to ask you earlier, what are some of the barriers to women getting maintenance for their children? Well, and men.
Lack of knowledge.
That wasn't an afterthought, but I know there are single dads out there.
It's not knowing your rights, and it's being fearful of going into this authoritative space, and that you're disempowered because you don't know your rights. So we have, through our group, we've established support groups. Our group is a huge support base. So you can rent, you can get information, and there are men and women on the group. There are government officials, there are lawyers. It's a whole community of people. And we really encourage people to see each other as parents on the group and support each other as such, because we really do care about the children. And as a result of that, we have 29 support groups around the country. So it's mainly on WhatsApp. And where there is a need, a beautiful story, one of our members fell pregnant with her second child, and she was going into labour. And somebody from her support group went and was her birth partner. And she also babysat her child. So there's others who go and feed others. There's others that share airtime. Because it empowers you. You just, it gives you a space to feel loved and cared for, and then also to support you in the court system.
That's amazing.
It is amazing. And Ronelle, we were speaking earlier about how now it takes a village. Yeah. It takes a village to raise a child. Some of us in our families, we see it happening. We see absentee fathers, absentee mothers, and sometimes those members are in our family.
Yeah.
How can we all get involved? How can we make it everyone's business? Yeah. Because I know in some cultures it's kind of like, it's got nothing to do with me. Yeah. Let me just leave it.
But
abuse continues to happen.
Absolutely. So again, it's working with yourself, allowing yourself that space to heal as much as possible, to actually accept help. So one of the mistakes I've made is that I just wanted to do it on my own. I'm independent, I don't need your help. And when I changed my whole narrative in my mind, and I changed my mindset, and I healed, now we are co-parenting so beautifully. He's the one that fetched the kids at school.
Sorry, we can just hold that too.
So it's about opening up yourself and accepting help. And you can co-parent fantastic. Again, one of the mistakes I made is to say I'm an independent woman, I can do this on my own. So I would limit the interaction with dad. And that's one of the mistakes I teach, to say that, listen, ask for that help, because that's the father, that's the child's father, and they look at him as a hero. And so ask for that help, and the fathers are sometimes willing, but you haven't healed, so you're sitting with all of the anger. So become less emotive, I would say, and accept help, whether it's from the other parent or from the community at large.
Yeah. It's also interesting for me how people who don't pay maintenance or abstain from paying maintenance are contributing to poverty on a larger scale in communities. Please elaborate on that for us.
Well, it starts with, first of all, every defaulter is somebody's son, somebody's brother, somebody's husband, boyfriend. And if we really want to make a difference, we need to start holding people accountable. You know, and it's one of those taboo subjects of don't drink and drive. We're quick to say that. or it's wrong to beat your wife up. But we don't hear people going, it is wrong not to financially support your children because of all the other, oh, you're just going to go and do your hair, you're going to go and do your nails.
Yeah, and when you see your friend living his best life and you know that his child doesn't have nappies, like, say something.
Call him to order.
We need to socially make them responsible. Mm. And it needs to become uncool. It needs to become the cool thing that you're an involved parent, that you both have your child's best interest. It's not just linked to poverty, but it is, because by not providing financial support, the child essentially is going without, because the mother will do what she needs to do to give, and she will go without. Mm. But the child is going without. There are children that are going to be hungry. And what next generation are we breeding? And it's directly linked to violence. And I'm absolutely committed to making a difference in the space that I can, because it's not just about money. It's very complex, it's very nuanced, and you can never just bring it to money. But paying the money is a good start, because it takes care of a whole lot of things. But as a nation, we have this historical context. Yeah. You know, there's migrant labor. There's a lot that contributes to all of this. And we need to be committed to going, we need to heal. There's lots, we need to heal on so many levels. We need to heal. We need to heal our spaces. We need to heal our communities. Yeah. We need to heal our children.
Yeah. Another interesting angle that I've seen is that we're focusing very much on mom and dad dynamic. But when this child grows up, sometimes it ends up breeding hurt adults, and a lot of hurt adults come up with excuses. Yeah. I can say, I don't know how to love because I didn't have a father. I don't know how to provide because I don't have. And I feel like those end up becoming cultural, or rather generational, curses that just go from one to another. Mm. So I think the responsibility also trickles down to the children when they do become adults to kind of choose a different life.
Yeah, change the narrative.
Like, I loved what you said earlier. Mm. You said, we're not the single parents of yesterday.
Yeah.
We don't have, that doesn't have to be our narrative.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, ladies, thank you so much for inspiring us today.
Thank you for having us.
Beautiful end to this Monday. Yeah. Absolutely. Join us again tomorrow as we chat to Danny Kay, one of my favorites growing up.
Good night. Mwah.
Afternoon Express, made with love by Clover.
Another feel-good production.